We know you love your doll, but we got you all those other toys, too, that you could play with. The robots and the teddy bear and the pig.
This is my home?
Yeah. This is your home.
Sweetheart.
You all right? You okay?
I'm so sorry.
Aw. That's good.
I wanted to credit you for the courage you had for tackling what is still a difficult topic. I'm not talking gay adoption here, I'm talking about showing 70s fashions on this screen. It's a risk, and you can cheat it. I've seen films set in the 70s, and I said, "Ooh, that tie isn't wide enough."
Yeah.
What was your decision there? And were you aware of the risk that you were taking there?
I wasn't aware that it was such a big risk. I was aware at a certain point. I talked to our costume designer Samantha Custer, and we started the first 2 or 3 days. I saw a couple of people on the set, and I was looking and I realized that we were kind of capturing an era, but there was no sort of specific 1979 exact fashion, and I wanted to just sort of create more of a feel as opposed to a very very tightly specific that year fashion, you know. So I didn't know that was a risk.
Was there any concern? I mean, did you have to think about running the risk of going like the Anchorman route?
I never saw the Anchorman.
Ah, okay.
I know that it's a risk to sort of go too broad with it and to try and, you know, make the shoes too big and the ties too big, and it can start to become sort of comical. So I just tried to, like I said, I lived, you know, I was born in 1968, so I remember 1970 and 1979. Just tried to make it honest and make it real, but at the same time be true to that era.
So my handy dandy Tribeca guide here tells me that this film was inspired by a true story. Where did you start from with this? Where did you want to take it? What did you need to do to make the story play for the screen?
Well, the original screenplay upon which the film is ultimately based was written back in the late 70s. A writer by the name of George Arthur Bloom knew this guy Rudy, who lived in the neighborhood over on Atlantic Avenue here in Brooklyn, knew that he sort of looked after this kid, and he was inspired enough to write the story about this character Rudy. He diverged from reality and set up a sort of notion of adoption and so his original screenplay, I had the pleasure of reading, and then we sort of took that script and rehabbed it, rebuilt it, you know, as you would an old house, and sort of brought it up to a story that I wanted to tell, something that I was very specific about.
Hello?
That guy looked familiar.
He does look familiar. So I very much wanted to take what was a story that was very relevant 40 years ago and try and tell a story that is equally relevant today, and infuse it with some personal experiences, some personal understanding of loss and grief, and make something that would ultimately move people, and also, you know, at the same time, make a bit of a statement about who should be allowed to determine who's allowed to love.
Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, Alan Cumming is a treasure.
He is.
I tend to think that when he's off camera, he's kicking dogs and throwing babies out of windows, or not, no. No. Okay. So I do want to talk, though, about Garret Dillahunt a little bit, because, you know, I tend to get late to the table on these things. I started paying attention to him, I think, last year with John Sayles, Amigo, and then watching him do a sort of white trash teddy bear in Raising Hope, and now this is a completely different person in your film. So when you started this off, I mean, did you have Garret in mind, and what did he bring to this?
I didn't have Garret in mind when I first started thinking about who would play the character. Thankfully, I had really, really good casting directors, Anya Koloff and Michael Niccolo, and they made me aware of Garret. I had obviously seen his work. I'd seen him in No Country for Old Men. I had seen him in some of the television work that he'd done, and always liked him, was always a fan of his. But he always plays a sort of dark, you know, sort of brooding, oftentimes, except Raising Hope, obviously, which is comedy. But as I started to watch his work more, I got excited by the idea of this guy who doesn't often get to play sort of the good guy, the hero. He's often playing these sort of dark, either dark or broadly comic. And what he brings to the character is just a quiet, simple, elegant, beautiful portrayal. I mean, it's sensitive, it's smart. There were a number of scenes when the cameras were rolling when I was both moved by his performance and I turned to my wife, who's my producing partner, one time as we were shooting a scene when we were in a courtroom, and I said, I want to work with this guy over and over and over again. He's not only a pro and really good at what he does, but he has these moments, these silent little moments, and I think there's a real power in that. I mean, obviously Alan has the lines. Alan has the bits and the moments. But Garret has the sort of, I think, this quiet intensity that I think without which the film just doesn't work.
And then you've got Isaac Leyva, mm-hmm. who plays Marco in this. I presume he has not acted in front of a camera before, or has he?
He had never acted professionally or in front of a camera before. Mm-hmm.
And how was it working with, I presume he is actually Down syndrome.
Yeah, he's right.
Is he right there?
He's right there.
Wait a minute here, let me see if I'm...
Should we bring him over and let him say hi?
If you want, yeah, sure. Hold on, I can't really get him, but...
Yeah.
Take my word, he's there. Okay, but what was it like working with him? How was he in front of the camera?
Isaac was exceptionally, he was exceptionally good to work with. The interesting thing that I found out very early on in the audition process, you know, because I think we oftentimes look at folks with handicaps, particularly mental handicaps, and there's this question, well, how much are they getting? Does he understand everything that's being said to him? Does he understand what I'm saying? Does he understand what I'm asking him? And through the audition process, I learned that he very much gets everything that's going on around him, what's being asked of him. And so what I realized is I could treat him like a quote-unquote normal actor and ask him to do certain things, give him directions, and then he was very good about following them. Sometimes even better than the pros, because the pros sometimes will go, well, why? You know, you say, lift your left leg, he'd lift his left leg for you. You know, and no knock on Alan or Garret or any Francis or any of the professional actors. They're smart, they've been doing it a long time. They would say, well, why am I lifting my left leg? They won't understand, you know, the connection that I'm... With him, he was a blank slate, and he followed my direction beautifully. And the most important thing that Isaac does when he's acting is he listens. And he truly listens and reacts. So he's got this emotion that's right there on the surface. So if the scene was sort of scary, there was a scene when his mother, he was asked to leave the room and there was some scary stuff going on, I didn't have to direct him. He was scared. And I didn't have to, you know, he was able to not have to access some memory of fear. He was reacting to what was in front of him, which was really, really beautiful to watch.
So this is set in the late 70s. Things have advanced considerably and still not quite there. So what do you feel this story does have to say to things as they are now?
Well, are you leaving just? Hey, Isaac, come here. Come here. We're doing an interview.
Hi.
Hi.
I'm Dan Persons. Good meeting you.
Nice to meet you.
So, very good performance, I thought. thank you very much. Did you enjoy doing it?
Yeah.
Good. I really appreciate it. Thank you.
Did you like working with me?
Yeah.
Was I a good director?
Mm-hmm.
The best ever, right? This guy's my buddy. All right, y'all done? Okay. I'm going to see you later, okay?
Okay.
All right, be ready for that red carpet tonight.
Okay.
Okay, buddy.
See ya.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
See ya. So I'm sorry, you were asking about political change
Yeah. And what does this story have to tell us now?
Well, it's interesting because when I first read the screenplay, you know, I'm a straight guy who lives in the suburbs with three quote-unquote normal kids in a cul-de-sac. I mean, I start to say, well, what's my connection to this? And why did I care so much about, when I first read the script, why did I care about telling the story as a filmmaker? I've never been sort of overtly political and wanted to sort of make social statements with film. I always wanted to just be a good storyteller. But what I understood, I have a 17-year-old daughter, and there's been some really, really painful personal stuff that's happened in my relationship with her and the way it's been affected by other people coming in. And I understand what it is to love somebody very much and to not be able to quite reach them and love them the way we want to. So ultimately, as I started to rewrite the script, I really wanted to tell a story not necessarily about gay rights, gay adoption, but about people who have love to give. And you don't stand in the way of it, because ultimately the people that get hurt are the people that have the love to give, the children who need somebody to love them, the parents who have love to give. Those are the people who end up getting hurt when you sort of stop this, you know. And why should we as a society at this point in this day and age, why should we stop anybody from giving or receiving the love based on their color, their creed, their sexuality, or whatever? In this day and age, there's no reason for that. So I do obviously think it will be talked about, and I think it should be talked about in terms of equality and gay rights. But also people understand that this is, losing love is something that can happen if you're straight. Losing love is not necessarily a gay issue, it's a human issue, you know.
Travis, thank you very much for talking with us.